According to the sacred Indian texts, which are called the Vedanta, there are only two symptoms of enlightenment. Just two indications that transformation is taking place within you toward a higher consciousness. And I thought this is interesting because we are all experiencing these two symptoms right now to some extent. The first symptom is that you stop worrying. Things don't bother you anymore, or they don't bother you as much. You become lighthearted and full of joy. This first symptom, a lot of people I've noticed have problems with. But the second symptom, a lot of people that I have read this to tell me they're actually experiencing. And that second symptom is that you encounter more and more meaningful coincidences in your life, more and more synchronicities. According to the Vedanta, this accelerates to a point where you actually experience daily miracles. So I thought when you were talking about meaningful coincidences and like-minded and like-hearted people coming together, this fits that scenario quite well. Yes, thank you for this opportunity. This is an extension to the regular lectures that we hold in the classroom, and we're hoping to appeal to a higher number of people than the traditional classroom gives us that opportunity. And it's good to be here.
I'm going to talk about different topics as far as, you know, bringing awareness to people, on humanity, politics. We were talking a little bit earlier about how can we help people learn a little bit more about what is truly out there, as far as, you know, there's a lot of people out there that worry too much about their problems, and when they watch news, all the information that comes at them is just all negative, and it doesn't allow them to really think outside of that box.
Yeah. Well, that's a very interesting point that you bring up. I think our first premise should be, or is, the fact that the people behind the news have a very diabolic agenda. Their agenda is not necessarily to inform. Their agenda is to keep people in a state of paralysis and fear. And the outcome of that agenda is that people become indifferent, people become aloof, and they're essentially paralyzed by fear, and they don't see any hope in making a change. Once we realize that's the real agenda behind people who control the media in this country, or around the world for that matter, and start tuning out of that and start tuning into alternative independent media, then we've made the first step. Because the information we will get from the independent alternative media, the journalistic integrity is there, whereas it's more or less missing in the corporate-owned mainstream media. Technology is a wonderful tool, but a negative side effect of technology is that people are not banded together. People are separated from one another. We sit in front of our iPods, in front of our laptops, in front of our PCs, completely secluded from one another. We are soaking information. We are controlling the inflow of that information at our own pace. Nevertheless, we're not having the benefit of face-to-face conversation. I believe that a lot can be achieved from good old-fashioned banding together in the same place at the same time, under the same banner. And a lot of the tendencies that people are feeling right now, people feel cut off, people feel helpless, there's a sense of despair out there. And rightly so, the issues that we're facing today are Herculean in dimension. Climate change, economic collapse, the devaluation of currency, foreign competition, the outsourcing of jobs. All these issues are systematic in nature, and there is a due reason for a lot of despair. But a wise man once said that life is 10% what happens to us, 90% how we react. A lot of people are reacting to just tune out, and that is exactly what the controllers of the system want people to tune out so they can continue with the agenda that they've been having in preparation for years, for centuries, some even say.
It's pretty interesting. Like, I think sometimes it's all planned out, because it all started like when we were young, or anybody. Like, for my example, I'd be like, in school they teach you not to talk to strangers.
Yeah.
Not to keep away from these type of people.
Yeah.
It's like, as you grow up, I mean, it's ridiculous. Like in Mexico, my parents are from Mexico. You go out there and, you know, you see older people, the elderly, and you say good morning to them, and you say hi to them, and you talk to them. And here, I noticed the other day, I was doing campaigning for some city out here, and there's a lot of like Latino community out there, and every time I would be walking by, and I'll see like an older man or something, and say, oh, buenos dias, you know, good morning or something. And then they'll just like look at me like nervously, like, what? Like, this young man actually spoke to me.
Yeah.
Because
the
way things are here is like everybody's in their own world. I'm individual.
Yeah.
Individualism. Like, what is that?
That time for the rugged individualism is coming to an end. As we're competing over more valuable resources, we realize that we need more cooperation than competition. This is going to be our new paradigm. What you talked about is very illustrative of a fear-driven agenda. Don't talk to strangers. People will harm you. This kind of mentality that we've been conditioned with since a very young age. And the time for that has come to an end. If we don't band together, if we don't cooperate, if we don't talk to strangers, if we don't compare ideas, if we don't compare our innovative solutions to systematic problems, we are essentially doomed as a species. So we have to change our paradigm. We have to do away with old habits. We have to have a connection again, not just with each other, but from members of previous generations. There seems to be a disconnect in the West, at least. Western European and North American cultures, where there's a generational gap. A lot could be learned from previous generations, their reactions to various stimuli that they were encountering. A lot could be learned. I've noticed that the generation from the Great Depression, most of whom are disappearing now, they're passing away. The tremendous economic hardship that they went through, this generation, your generation, could learn a lot from. The sense of frugality, sense of saving versus just mindless consumption and spending. Your generation could learn a lot from a sense of the fact that resources are not limitless. What you talked about is very illustrative of a fear-driven agenda. Don't talk to strangers. People will harm you. This kind of mentality that we've been conditioned with since a very young age. And the time for that has come to an end. If we don't band together, if we don't cooperate, if we don't talk to strangers, if we don't compare ideas, if we don't compare our innovative solutions to systematic problems, we are essentially doomed as a species. I think this is where the American model could be exemplary. The multiculturalism. The fact that we have a very large Latin American minority within the States is a plus, not a minus. You could learn from that culture, the attributes of that culture, the family orientedness of that culture, the group cohesiveness of that culture. That's been missing in Western European and North American cultures where it's rugged individualism, you and you alone, that whole model of John Wayne riding on his horse into the sunset. The time for that paradigm has come to an end.
Yeah, like me, I have my own production company. I'm still going currently to film school and all that. And I I'd like to, I know that there's a lot of artists out there just like me that want to speak out and, you know, but don't have the right equipment or, you know, the access to certain, you know, things. Mm-hmm. I've been fortunate, you know, to be able to have, you know, what I do have at a young age. I mean, I'm not young and I'm not that old, but, you know, I like to connect with other artists, even if they're not artists.
Yeah.
Non-artists. Like, I'm really open. I want to help whoever I can.
Yeah.
And, you know, and we network. I know that, you know, if I really want to be a successful filmmaker, I can't do it all on my own.
Yeah. Well, connections are integral. Connections are absolutely priceless. And that's what you essentially have done. You have connected with me, and we are helping each other. You know, I'm helping you expand your horizons. I'm helping you, or you're helping yourself, actually. I'm just instructing you, sort of pointing you to that direction where you would think critically, where you would question authority, where you wouldn't take things at their value, but you would think critically. I think all these skills would be invaluable to you in your career.
Why is it so hard for us as the people to really question our society? There's a lot of people out there that I believe that they don't question it, but they complain about it, but they don't question about it.
Yeah, I think it's a question of miseducation or not being educated correctly, whereas questioning authority or dissent is not something that's discouraged, but it should be something that is encouraged. We're talking about constructive criticism. You're not talking about shallow, destructive criticism just for the sake of criticism. That's not what we're talking about. Bob Dylan said something very interesting a few decades ago, where he said, "Don't criticize what you don't understand." So our goal should be to understand the complexity of these issues that we're all facing. And then after that, to criticize constructively, to build, not to destroy. Having said that, the old has to be destroyed before the new can be built. And that's where we are at right now. We are literally in the process of a lot of our models self-destructing on themselves because they were not sustainable in the first place. They were short-term oriented, and now we're seeing the destruction. We're seeing the destruction of the financial system around the world. Social disorder is going to be next. All these things are foreshadowing of what's going to emerge out of it, a new order, a new paradigm, a new model, a new understanding of how things operate. Most people get caught up in the chaos that we are currently experiencing, and they lose hope. In mythology, in histomythology, in various religious traditions of the East, what we are going through right now has been foretold. The crisis that we're all facing as humanity, as a species, has been foretold. So we need to keep our eyes on the ball and not lose hope. That is one thing we cannot afford to do. We need to know that the pain that we're facing as a species is temporary. A lot of it is self-induced. We have the tools to help ourselves out of this, but it requires a new way of looking at things. It requires a new understanding. And that's where the challenge lies. The ability to change or to do things the way we have been doing it. It just happens to be that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing and expecting a different circumstance or a different outcome. Yeah. That seems to be where we're at, isn't it?
You're right.
We are gods, that we are the creator, the wholly owned creator of our own realities. And this has led into nothing but narcissism, self-worship, short-sightedness, and in certain religious traditions, they would simply call this blasphemy. And these people pose as teachers, as solution providers, as guides, and they're anything but.
They just want to make their sales.
They want to make their quick sale. It comes down to dollars and cents. They're very shrewd. They know what people are lacking right now. In times of uncertainty, people want certainty, people want empowerment, but these false teachers go about empowering people in the completely wrong ways. They're touching on their sense of narcissism. They're touching on their, you know, self-esteem issues or lack thereof, and they're trying to build them up in the wrong way. We really have to keep our eyes on this. In Judeo-Christian traditions, there's a long history of warning the masses against people like this, against false messiahs like this. These people go around claiming they have extraordinary powers, that they're channelers, that they have direct access to ascended masters. And when you actually sit down and listen to them channeling the ascended masters, you realize that the information that's coming out of them is so rudimentary and so remedial. You wonder how these masters became ascended in the first place. That it's really not about the ascended masters, quote unquote. It's about them.
Right.
It's about them finding a sense of identity.
Well, they know the right people to reach.
The right people to fool.
The most ignorant ones.
The most ignorant ones, the ones that don't know how to think critically, the ones that are very sheepish in nature. Broad is the way to destruction. Narrow is the way to salvation. That's how it is. When you see a horde of people following a group, you should be warned.
Zombies.
Like, more or less like zombies. They're under hypnosis, various levels of hypnosis. And we have to be very careful of that. Of course, we know that watching television, a certain extent, number of hours of watching television puts you into a certain level of hypnosis.
Right.
Yeah. So, and this is the, sadly, commentary of modern times, where we are cut off from one another, we're not talking anymore, we're texting, we're emailing, we're Facebooking, we're not sitting in the same space and discussing things. A lot of good could come out of that. A lot of camaraderie and solidarity could come out of being in the same space and talking these issues over. We may not be able to solve these, you know, very complex issues overnight, but the fact of talking about it is therapeutic in nature. Technology, as wonderful as it is, as a wonderful tool as it is, doesn't provide that venue in many cases. It's the same as taking online classes. A lot of my students who have taken online classes come back to the regular class with a live professor instructing, and they have a completely different appreciation for real classes. So technology is nothing but a tool. It's not an end to itself. It's a means to a higher end. Society today is treating technology as an end. And that's where the disconnect is.
Yeah, like me, I was thinking of taking a couple of online courses and stuff. And I just decided, no, I want to have the professor there.
The interaction.
Interaction with other students.
Other students, yes.
We'll talk about the topics that we're talking about, but, you know, in the downtime, talk to other people.
Because a lot of learning could take place from one another. Right. Whereas where you're sitting behind a computer and you're just writing or completing a bunch of assignments, you may not get that same benefit from the regular old-fashioned classroom.
Right.
And technology, in this sense, is doing us a disservice. It's an Orwellian situation. George Orwell talked about this in 1984. It's incredible. He was a prophet of modern times. He talked about this disintegration or disconnection from one another facilitated through technology. And so we have to be very much on the lookout this.
And then, like, say, like, for example, now you see we got a bunch of people, you know, protesting against, like, Wall Street, the banks.
Against the order, the current order.
And, you know, can you see any, like, resemblance between the people that are protesting now and, like, back when we had hippies and, you know,
well, definitely I can see similarities. And this is a wonderful thing. People coming out of the houses that they're getting foreclosed on, banding together, expressing their outrage, expressing their dissent, their social dissent, together, finding a sense of camaraderie, finding their own voice. This is how change is implemented. This is what the founding fathers of this great country had in mind. Not just being disconnected from one another and suffering silently, which is a lot of what's happening right now. A lot of people are suffering silently. More than 50 million Americans are taking one shape or form of an antidepressant. Now, I'm not putting down people who are taking antidepressants. I'm talking about the fact that a lot of people are unhappy. We could do away with a lot of this unhappiness if we relearn the art of social interaction, the art of trusting one another, the art of opening to strangers, the art of venting to one another. Mm-hmm. A lot of good could come out of that, even though we may not be able to find quick solutions to the problems that we have. It has taken us a long time to get to where we are right now, and it's not going to take us overnight to step out of this quicksand. It's going to take a lot of teamwork and like-mindedness and like-heartedness and a lot of trial and error to snap out, for lack of a better term, out of this mess that we're in. Mm-hmm. The mess we're in, it took us a good 200 years to get into, since the advent of cheap energy, cheap petroleum. So it's going to take a lot of time to create alternative solutions. The good thing is that the positive thing is that technology, because of the rapid flow of information, technology could be quite positive, could play quite a positive role in this facilitating change. Because something that happens right now, through technology, through Facebook, for example, a person on the other side of the world could know within a matter of a few seconds. So that has quickened the time itself.
Right.
The learning process has been quickened because of technology. So if we learn to look at technology from that perspective, then there's hope for us. Otherwise, if we let technology master us and take ownership of us, then really nothing has changed. We have essentially dehumanized ourselves.
Even quicker.
Even quicker. Exactly. That's the paradox of it. Even quicker. And we have become slaves to robots and technology itself. I don't believe people like Steve Jobs and Bill Gates had this in mind back in the 60s and 70s and early 80s, mm-hmm. when they were promoting technology. These people were hippies themselves. They were spiritual in nature. All the stuff that are coming out on Steve Jobs, we're realizing he was a deeply spiritual man. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the people who followed them, the petty business people who only saw dollars and cents out of this new technology or new paradigm, mm-hmm. They're the ones that are sort of taking us into a direction we should try to avoid.
From any, like just anything, avoid going in that direction as far as, having your own business here and then going globally.
Without having any ethical,
right.
Considerations.
I understand why corporations are doing what they're doing in other nations. It's for the dollar signs,
Yeah, you have to keep in mind that not all corporations are evil in nature or in intent. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of companies that are doing quite a lot of good. But again, the media doesn't want to cover that side.
Right.
The media decided a long time ago that if they inject fear and unhappiness and anger, that is what people want to hear of. Their own polls are contradicting that right now, because people are no longer watching the mainstream media. Mm-hmm. There has never been a time in this country where less and less people were tuning into their nightly news broadcast. People don't want to hear things from that fear-infested perspective. People want to hear hope. People want a sense of solution. That's how this Obama got into office. Of course, what he has done since he got into office is quite different than what everything that he promised. But people want real, authentic, grassroots change.
Right.
That's what the Tea Party was all about. That's what this Wall Street Occupation movement that's gone viral is all about. It's about real, authentic, grassroots change. Change must come from the bottom up. It never comes from top to bottom. Because people at the top don't want change. They want things to stay static. They want things to stay the same. It's in their short, again, if they had a long-term orientation, they would know that this would even be against their own gain. But they seem to have a short-term orientation. There's this end-game mentality that they're headed toward a cliff. And before you jump off the cliff, you want to amass as much wealth as possible. Mm-hmm. This is the mentality that we're faced with. As long as we have that mentality, and as long as the masses subscribe to that, there's no hope, there's no change, and things will stay static.
Nice.
So I think I think the founder fathers would be proud if they saw how Americans are waking up. They're waking up out of, you know, out of their hypnosis. A real American revolution is underway as we're speaking. When the people on the right find solidarity with people on the left and create this mass movement, then change becomes inevitable. And that's when you have a real, tangible change.
There's something interesting that you said in the class, the global marketing. Mm-hmm. Our founding fathers would be, if they were here today, they would be hip-hop artists.
Yeah.
What is that?
Well, you know, we have hip-hop artists and then we have hip-hop artists. You know, we can't just paint them all with the same brush. We have the hip-hop artists like Immortal Technique, people like them who are socially charged, politically charged, who have a message, whose message is not about the integration of women or over-sexualizing everything. So we have authentic hip-hop, and then again, you won't hear that in the mainstream media.
Right.
You have to go to the alternative scene to get a taste of that. They're rebels with a cause. They're not rebels without a cause, they're rebels with a cause. And that's essentially, in my opinion, who the founding fathers were. They were way ahead of their time. They had a sense of zeitgeist, which in German, my understanding of German is that they had their hand on the pulse of the society, that understanding, good understanding of the past, a good sense of understanding of the present, and an anticipation for a future they wanted to create. They had a good zeitgeist. So if they came back today, in my opinion, one of the things that some of them would have probably done was to join the hip-hop movement, or at least the socially conscious hip-hop movement. I would say the same thing about Beethoven and Mozart and these people at their times are rebels. Mozart was a Freemason, and at that time Freemasonry was it had not denigrated to what it has become today. It was a good positive movement against the European aristocracy. Beethoven, you know, he wrote one of his symphonies dedicated to Bonaparte, Napoleon Bonaparte, because they saw Bonaparte as a liberator of the European masses against this, royal social aristocracy that was in power then. Of course, later on, when he found out that Napoleon himself was a despot, that he was an authoritarian ruler, he recanted. His earlier statements, but at that time they were revolutionaries, and nothing has changed. These people are still living today, except that their music or their message is coming through other methods or other genres of music.
Because going to public school and stuff, they teach you about the founding fathers. Teach us about our founding fathers,
but from a very superficial perspective, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And then whenever they touch the subject of like Native Americans, they only kind of talk a little bit about Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
We move on.
Or slavery, for that matter.
Slavery. They'll just talk about a little bit about slavery, yeah. The cotton. Okay, let's move on.
Yeah.
And that doesn't like. The real education doesn't come through until later, until you go to college, and you start taking these courses, and there's some professors that will open your eyes even more, but I think the better education is you doing it yourself, going out there and, you know, finding these.
And that's another benefit of technology. You can give yourself a good education as long as you have access to the internet, and you know, there's a lot of information that's quite interesting when you just go on Wikipedia and research it yourself. So you don't necessarily, it depends on how much drive you have.
Exactly.
How much thirst you have for knowledge or to hear things that you are not normally accustomed to hearing. To deprogram yourself from the robot that you've been programmed into becoming.
So how can we connect with those people that are so tuned into being zombified and what society wants them to do? Mm-hmm. How can we, like, because I know if you go into those people and talk to them straightforward on how things are, they'll be like, it's too much information, I think.
Information overload.
And I think they'll
tune out.
Yeah, they'll tune out. They'll be like, oh, this.
Yeah, this I think we have a couple crazy. Of people like that in the class. Oh. They just tune out. It's too much for them. But then again, the question arises, why are you there in the first place?
Correct.
You know, if you don't want to be challenged, just take the class online. And you just browse through the PowerPoints and take the test online.
Right.
But if you really want the dynamic of a classroom and a debate, an ongoing debate and social criticism, then that's where you're there. I think you don't really necessarily need to approach the problem in a sense of having to reach to these people. I think the situation right now, the circumstances are so dire straits that they will reach out to you. I mean, people are losing their jobs. When people's homes go on foreclosure, when people see their jobs being outsourced to places like China and India and other developing nations that have a much higher drive in absorbing these jobs because their labor costs are lower. So when they see all these, it's a perfect storm.
Mm-hmm.
When they see all these things happening and everyone, this is at the forefront of everyone's consciousness right now. They may not necessarily admit to it, but it's, the process is taking place there. You don't need to reach out to them. All you have to do is wait for them to come to you. And this is what we're seeing today. What we're talking about today, we have talked about for at least 2 or 3 decades. Nobody was listening 20 years ago. Nobody was listening 10 years ago. Suddenly everybody is listening now. Mm-hmm. Right?
Sure that.
World's changing circumstances almost dictate people waking up. When in physics, for example, they call it the critical mass. When we reach that critical mass where the balance, 51% or more, suddenly 51% of the population is more aware, is more awake than the 50%, than the 49%, that's when we reach critical mass, and that's when we'll see change. Because everyone will see it in their own vested interest to become involved in the change that's taking place. You don't have to go change the world overnight. This is one thing I was talking to a colleague of mine. The person who's, you know, opening the door or standing by the door in Walmart and is greeting people and has a sense of purpose in what he does.
Mm-hmm.
Right? There's honor in every line of work. Whether you're an academic like us, who are working from behind the scenes, or the person who's doing very remedial work. There's honor in every level of work.
Right.
It's how satisfied you are with what the kind of service that you're providing, that you're doing the best that you can, that you're living up to your potential. That's what matters. I was reading to John Lennon's Working Class Hero, the lyrics to the song Working Class Hero. And one day after we dismissed the class, I was there doing some work, and I had this most interesting discussion with the janitor. These people are looked upon as pariahs. Nobody talks to them. They come late at night to do their work.
Mm-hmm.
And yet without them, I mean, it's one of the most important jobs, and yet people don't put value in that occupation. So it doesn't really matter what job title we have, as long as we're providing a service that is necessary to society, and as long as we have a sense of fulfillment in doing what we're doing. You as a filmmaker, me as an educator, the janitor as a person who's providing hygiene and cleanliness
for the
environment that
he
is in, the students. Yeah, everyone has to fulfill their own function. That's how the wheel turns. That's how society functions.
It's a balance.
There's a balance. Not everybody was meant to be a janitor. Not everybody was meant to be a leader. Not everybody was meant to be a professor. Not everybody was meant to be a filmmaker like you.
Mm-hmm.
So it's finding your niche, feeling comfortable in that niche, and then doing the best you can. Finding your purpose. You know, stop swimming against the stream and just going along with the stream and letting it carry you to where it's meant to carry you. In my personal spiritual belief, I believe that we're all here. We all made it a conscious decision to be born at the time that we're living in right now. Everyone who's alive today was meant to be born exactly at these crucial times. I think we discussed it in the class, and a lot of eyes were opening. I brought up the fact that most people who are living today are solution providers, whether they know it or not. Because we have reached a time in the human evolution where all the problems are surfacing. All the problems from all the previous times and previous generations are surfacing. And once again, we are at that crossroad. And so everyone who's alive today has a sense of manifest destiny. I strongly believe that. This is, again, my personal belief. I'm not propagating that. I'm just stating that. And once we find out that niche and we feel truly happy and content and fulfilled, the possibilities are limitless. It's just about, you know, having that courage to find that place. Having that peace of mind, that peace of heart to be in that place, to fulfill that role.
Sometimes we need to go through certain changes within our lives.
Absolutely.
Eventually reach that.
Absolutely. We all go through what I call the dark night of the soul. The dark night of the soul is perhaps the best thing that could happen to you. Your old paradigm crushing on you, and you having to reinvent yourself. Again, this is what in the Judeo-Christian tradition, particularly the Christian tradition, is referred to as purification through pain. But the church didn't understand for 2,000 years that they interpreted that as actual physical pain. We are talking about a psychological pain that's supposed to take place within you for you to awaken to a new reality and then follow the purpose that was intended for you even before you were born. And that you can only reach that place after having gone through the dark night of the soul and somehow being able to transcend from that and reinvent yourself, reinvent your purpose in life. So, only then.
So would you say that that happens throughout people's lives continuously, or it's just like
some people try to deny it, some people try to delay it. It will happen whether you like it or not at some stage in your life. The earlier it happens, the better it would be for you. In a lot of animistic cultures, like African cultures, they have a shaman or a witch doctor or a solution provider, whatever you want to call it in modern language, in the village. And the shaman, he or she has gone through a lot of trials and tribulations, especially very early in their life. They had to go through that to experience that pain firsthand, mm-hmm. so they could help the entire community, so they could help the village. That was the way it was meant to be. I remember when I was going through a lot of rough times, somebody turned around to me and said, God gives the most challenges to the ones whom he loves the most. When I first heard that, I was very irate, because I was thinking, what kind of God are we talking about here? Is this some kind of a sadistic God who takes joy in giving pain to me? But the more I took anger out of that statement, out of the way I felt about that statement, the more I realized, yeah, that's the way it works. The more challenges you're given to, that means you're ready to partake those challenges and to transcend from them. And be who you are really meant to be. Become all you can become.
Not like the army.
The army, interestingly, it's funny you mentioned it because I was thinking exactly what you just said. That came out from a brief period within the modern U.S. Army's history. A lot of veterans from the Vietnam era came into the army trying to create army a new paradigm, a new sort of reality, a new way of reacting to things. And I think the movie The Men Who Stare at Goats truly captures this class of army officers and staff. My colleagues in the army, the ones that I talk to, say that movie was not far from the truth at all.
Wow.
A lot of the things that were exposed in that movie were straight from some of the experiments that were taking place in the early and early 90s within various branches of the military. So yeah, becoming all you can be. Not in a sense of going and destroying somebody else's belonging or homeland, but in a sense of becoming a better person, first and foremost for yourself, then for the people around you, your family, your loved ones, and then at the next level for society. That's how real change takes place, for everybody to come to that realization.
Little by little, all these changes that are going on in various groups in society, little by little, they're all going to be that 151%.
And that's the hope. They're waking up. What made them wake up? The foreclosure crisis really gave people a sense of awareness of how corrupt the system really is. So it was through, again, through pain and trials and tribulations that forced people to wake up, because people may not wake up voluntarily. Mm-hmm. Something has to always push them.
Right.
A little bit. You know? Push, change has to come incrementally. Can't happen too fast, too sudden, or it'll be traumatic, which is what a lot of people are experiencing right now. After having lost their jobs, they see no hope of a new job. They lost their home. They lost their family. Their wives left them. So change too quickly is not healthy. But change taking place incrementally at a slow pace is what human evolution, the psychological evolution for humanity, is all about. And that's what we are witnessing right now. We are in the midst of it right now as we're speaking. The Mayans believe that we are at that stage. They foretold this, for example. Many people believe that the events that are leading to the next year, 2012, there's going to be some kind of a, not necessarily cataclysmic event, but some kind of a defining moment where humanity will rise to its potential. Mm-hmm. Of course, is that how Hollywood portrays 2012? Absolutely not. So earthquakes and doom and gloom and fear and many people dying, they have their agenda. That's not how we see it. We see it as a new beginning, not an end. There is no end of the world. There will be an end of humanity if we don't change our course, but the world itself will go on. The Earth itself will go on. Earth has self-correcting mechanisms. That's what climate change is all about.
Correct. Yes.
Earth will go on. We, as a very minuscule species on this planet, our existence may be in question if we don't change course. And that's what the message should be. Not this horrible events that are going to happen to us and you're just going to be, you know... The world is not going to end. Humanity itself may end if you don't change course, if you don't realize, if you don't wake up. But the world will not end. The sky will not fall down. I can guarantee you that. Yeah.
So, Professor, tell us, why did you go into the career that you went into?
I came to a realization, again, after having gone through my dark night of the soul. And this was not one night. It was years that I went through this change within myself. I realized that my existence makes the most sense to me when I'm being of service to others. And I found teaching to be that particular line of service that equipped me. I come from a family of teachers. My paternal side, my dad, my aunts, they were all teachers at one shape or form. And it took me a while to come to that realization that this line of work really suits me. When I'm coaching, when I'm motivating others, when I'm facilitating knowledge and learning, that it gives my existence a meaning. That it's not about me, that it's about the people that I'm helping. That I'm just the channel that is helping facilitate something or create something better out of people. I like to think of myself as what Michelangelo did, for example. They put a beautiful, or actually not so beautiful, they put a block of marble in front of him, and through chipping at that marble, he brought out this beautiful statue. In a way, I see my purpose in that. When I have students in the first day of the class, they're a block of marble, they have tremendous potential, each and every one of them, and we have to chip away at them, me as well as them, into bringing out the best out of them. Mm-hmm. Or to help them find out where they fit in this world, what their purpose is in this world, what particular area of what I teach, for example, what particular area of global business they would like to go into. So to help them become more conscious of their own consciousness, help them become more aware of their own sense of purpose. That's essentially what we do as educators. Our job is not to regurgitate knowledge. Anyone can go and read the book on their own. Our job is to fill in where the textbook doesn't. And we bring our vast, you know, years of experience from outside of the classroom into the classroom, and we let you guys benefit from that.
And do you ever feel like, even though you teach the same courses, but you get like the feedback that you get from your students, like you're relearning again
every absolutely time? Every time I teach a course, I'm teaching it from a different perspective. I never use the same PowerPoints, for example. It's a learning process for me as well. Mm-hmm. I switch publishers just to see a different perspective of what I'm teaching. I bring in a lot of outside materials. I don't teach the same course the same way. It always varies from semester to semester. Mm-hmm. That's what makes it interesting for me. That's what makes it challenging for me. That's what makes it critical for me, because I try to implement critical thinking into what I teach. That's what helps me not become static and stationary. It helps me be fluid and flexible. And so it definitely is a learning process. It's not just learning for the students, it's also learning for us. Previously, in various human traditions, they defined that higher power as God. Today, we use different terminology for it. Higher consciousness or prime directive, perhaps. The idea is to transcend. Transcend from who we were before into who we want to become. There's a Zen proverb, a Zen Buddhist proverb that says, when the master is ready, the master, with a capital T and a capital M, will appear. When the master is ready, the small master, then the master will appear. And that's the God within all of us, the God element within every human being alive today. When that God from within wakes up and becomes conscious or alert of his or her full potential, that's when we see actual change taking place. And that's slowly taking place right now. A lot of people are becoming aware, again, through their own trials and tribulations, through their pains, through the rapid changes that are taking place. A lot of people have to adapt, and they're adapting, for better or worse.
So like, for instance, like what you're just wanted to clarify a little bit more, you're talking about the little master turning into a big master, like the inner God.
Yeah.
And then earlier you were talking about how people believe that there are their own gods.
Yes. We have to distinguish between that. When I'm talking about when the master is ready, the small me, the master will appear. I'm not talking about just me appearing again. I'm talking about that higher transcendent power suddenly manifesting himself more in my life. Mm-hmm. It's something external of me, and yet I'm just like a drop in the ocean, part of the ocean. A drop in the ocean is part of the ocean, but that drop is not the entire ocean.
Right.
That's where a lot of people in the New Age movement, these blasphemers, as I like to call them, get it wrong. They think the drop is the ocean. The drop contains elements of the ocean, but it's still a drop. Together, collectively, it becomes the ocean. That's how we define God as the collective consciousness, the big picture. Mm-hmm. But the drop is not God itself. It's just a part of a grander scheme. So that needs to be clarified. Again, that's becoming, it's almost being lost in translation today, again, because of the insistence of a lot of these false teachers out there who are misleading many people, telling people that they're gods, telling people that they're it. Not too long ago, I met someone who was reading a book that was called Now You're God, What Next? And I had no desire to even open that book. With a title like that, I realized from cover to cover, it's nothing but self-grandiosity and narcissism. So we have to be, very cautious of that. There's a Christ consciousness alive within each and every one of us, but then there's a different layer, a higher layer of a God or God reality that we are a minute part of. Space exploration is certainly helping us with that notion. We realize how small we are, and yet we are part of a greater consciousness. We are part of a greater system, but we're just a small part of it.
But sometimes we spend too much time and money exploring the outer space than
our own problems,
than our own, like what we could really achieve, with our own planet. I mean, they've been, I've seen a couple of films or stuff like that, documentaries, where they're going into deep sea and they're finding, you know, these weird
creatures,
species, and they're able to like extract like some of their venom and stuff, and how they're using that venom to, you know,
for medical cures,
and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's a mysterious world out there, whether it's in our own planet or out there. Keep in mind that all the space exploration that we did in the 60s and 70s, that gave people a sense of hope, a sense of a future to look forward to. Since they took that away, and, you know, our budgets really determine our morality. Most people don't realize that when you look at a budget, when you look at a ledger, when you look at where the money is flowing, that determines where what our morality is about. What are we, you know, spending our resources on? NASA's budget is so minuscule compared to Pentagon's overall budget that it's almost laughable. And yet, a lot of the technology that we use on a daily basis, you know, home, like the microwave, like so many things, they're initially were explored through, you know,
NASA department.
Exploration into space. Yeah, it was part of a NASA invention. And it became mass-produced, and we used it in our homes. So there's benefit to come out of that. It's just that we have to come to a level of evolution, a level of awareness as a whole, humanity as a whole, to realize that war and destruction and hostile takeover of other people's resources, this is not a long-term solution to solve our problems. As a matter of fact, it's the exact opposite. It will create enmity and hate and revenge further down the line.
So it's a bubble ready to
bust. It's exactly what it is. At some point, we have to wake up at, you know, and realize that working together will be more lucrative and sustainable in the long term than hostile takeover and bullying of each other and hostile takeover of each other's resources. We have to come to that realization, or we are doomed, or we'll have, you know, continuous wars, non-ending wars,
and even more rapid
decline, even more rapid, you know, disintegration. We have to come to that understanding at some level, at some time in our evolution. Or honestly, we are doomed.
So basically, the time is right. The time is now.
The time is right. The time is now. This is the moment of reality. This is the moment of truth. Again, we are at that crossroad. And we have been at these crossroads at previous times in our history, where we had to choose a certain path that would lead to advancement and scientific growth and betterment of life for the people on the planet, or we choose one route that would take us into darkness and ignorance and self-destruction and all the horrible symptoms and consequences.
So it's history repeating itself.
History only repeats itself when people don't know their history. If people know their history, then they will not repeat it.
Then we can create change.
Then we can create change, we can create new reality. History only repeats itself for people who don't know their history, who don't have a sense of understanding of their history. And this is how important it is in how you teach history at the K-12 level, at the college level, and even at the graduate level. The more realistic and critical you teach history, the lower the odds of history repeating itself. History repeats itself for the ignorant. The ignorant will have history repeating because they are doing the same thing,
right,
and expecting a different outcome. That makes them basically insane. And humanity is many times has gotten close to that insanity until something changed within us, some awareness came within us. The right teachers were amidst us and they helped us overcome our ignorance.
Nice. Yeah, nicely said.
Thank you.
Thank you. Like, this to me is like a miracle to be able to talk to someone that is really educated in all these different topics, and we're here working together, you know. with this video and this production, we'll be able to help other people understand a little bit more better of the basically the secret knowledge of that's there in the books that not a lot of us tend to
apply it
or reach out to read a book, because in the society or a trend that we're in now.
I mean, obviously that where we're at right now, the learning process is facilitated more in the audiovisual department than the old-fashioned way of reading things. The benefit of reading things is that you can pace the amount of information that you're intaking. With audiovisual, more or less you're bombarded with images and information combined. This generation, your generation, tends to identify more with the latter than the former. It doesn't really matter, as long as learning takes place and information is soaked and people interpret that information in a positive way to make a positive change in the world, that's really the focus, that's the emphasis. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. I enjoyed our conversation. Hopefully this will be one in a series of strategic conversations that we're going to have, and we're going to put it on the net, put it up on YouTube, and share it with people and get inputs, and try to create an environment for people where they feel that their concerns are being addressed, right? That the issues that they're grappling with in their mind is being verbalized and is being addressed.
Someone's talking about it.
Someone is talking about it. We're hoping more and more people will join in and talk about it from a very sober, scientific, and yet spiritual perspective, and that we would find some sense of solidarity and comfort in venting together. Right?
Yes.
Good. Well, I enjoyed this.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Professor.
You're welcome.